Okay, we'll call this meeting to order at, I think it's 5:30-ish. We'll start with the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Board member Mrs. Bridle will be a little bit late, but she's coming. Okay. Board member updates. Frank, anything?
None.
Pepper, anything? Nothing. Andra, anything?
Jay's going to be upstairs with the rec department.
No, we're still going through policy things, and that's about it.
Public comment on agenda items? Anybody from the huge crowd? No? Okay. Okay. I guess we can start with your report. This is an abbreviated board meeting tonight because we're going to be working on budget. But before we go to you, before we go, do the principals have any announcements or anything that they'd like to, anything going on?
Veterans Day assemblies tomorrow.
You want, can you do it at the mic? That'd be good.
Hi. Good evening.
Tomorrow we have our annual Veterans Day assembly. Burke Bennett from Commuter Post 35 at the American Legions will be there to speak to our students. And Gus Carlson has arranged a writing contest where the students will have an opportunity to share their thank you letters. So just a wonderful annual tradition that we love having our veterans come in so that we can properly say thank you. We also invite any parents who may be veterans that would like to come in to take part in our ceremony. So that's tomorrow, and it will begin at about 10:15. By the time they all get there, we'll head down.
Great.
Yeah, so everyone's welcome.
And we keep the veterans busy as well. They'll come to Hampton Academy tomorrow morning at 8:40. Instead of doing an assembly, we participate in a program that's run by the Discovery Channel. It's called Take a Veteran to School Day. And again, the ladies and gentlemen from Post 35 come in, and we break the kids into small groups, and the kids have been kind of prepped. We find out why they served, what they did in the service, what motivated them, what their day-to-day life was. And it's just as meaningful for the veterans as it is for the kids. So it's, we still do a Memorial Day, but it's a little different twist on Veterans Day. And I think it's now our third year in this program, and it seems to be going very well.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Tim?
Just a couple of things. Just like the other two principals, we do also recognize Veterans Day. We do it more in a all-school format under the responsive classroom. It's a more of an introduction of what is Veterans Day. The attention span isn't so much about all the veterans coming in. We prep them to get ready for the programs over the year, and we do it through songs and activities, and it's an internal-based program that we have. At the end of the month, on the 22nd, we have, as part of our all-school assembly, we have what's called the sharing assembly, where we donate canned goods and foods and items to the needy. And so I want to make sure the parents that are listening will be getting some information on donating some goods on November 22nd as part of our all-school sharing assembly, okay? That's all I have. Thank you.
Great. Thank you. Okay. Kathleen?
Pretty normal report. Curriculum and assessment is moving along. We had a great day today with social studies, an all-day workshop with the new social studies curriculum, and we had representation from all of the schools as well as grade levels, so there was an excellent exchange. I was pretty pleased about that. Professional development, lots of professional development going on. We had a full-day workshop at the end of the month in October. October. And it was a variety of workshops, and I inserted the agenda for that workshop day in your packet so you can take a peek at it. I have some folks in the district that really helped out. Janine Richards, Jessica Parsons both helped out with a big piece around the social emotional learning piece, as well as a meeting with folks from the DOE on the McKinney-Vento and the regulations around that, as well as meeting with Division of Children and Youth Services so that people understood the work that they do to support the school. So shout out to those two. They did a great job in setting that up. Nathan and I both have been very busy with professional development. We outlined it in here, and that's really important. That's our chance to see what's going on around the state, as well as learning around new things for us. So I did outline that in the report. You have some retirements we'll talk about later, and we'll get into that. And then I just kind of gave an idea about where we've been in terms of activities in the community. Probably the most of our work this month was getting to you about a budget and having it in order for you, because as you know, after you finish with this budget, very quickly we'll be visiting with the budget committee on December 8th. And so after tonight's meeting, we hope that we'll have some bottom line so that we can begin to put that together. And last but not least is the Hampton Academy Facilities Project. Great committee, lots of involvement. And I also put notes and agendas in your packet so that you can see what those committees, that committee is doing. Just a reminder, they are coming next week, next Wednesday, 5:30 here. It'll be televised. And the committee is coming in with their recommendation to you relative to the project. So we'll have the project and we'll have the costs of the project for you for your deliberation. Okay, so that'll happen next week. We have our first handout that we developed. We're always reaching out into the community to ensure that the public has information about the project. So this is just a quick little handout that people can use to share information. I thought I'd let you see it. These just came in. Dave worked with Geskis, and they printed these for us at no cost, I might add. So other than that, I answer any questions.
Any questions for the superintendent? Frank?
None.
Pepper?
No.
Andrea? Okay. I did receive this from the superintendent. The Hampton Town Clock Committee cordially invites you and your family to a rededication ceremony for the Hampton Town Clock this Sunday, November 13th, at noon at the Clock Tower, the Center School, Winnicott Road. So I think that's for anybody who's so inclined. Can we move to the calendar?
We sure can. In your packet tonight is a calendar. I also put a refreshed calendar in front of you. There was just one little minor change from the one that was in your packet. And we also wanted to align it up a little bit better, so we changed some of the format so it was a little bit easier to read. But the process is the same. We get a recommended calendar from the DOE. They give us an idea when there's vacations, when it's appropriate, and days that we should be taking off. I meet with the administrative team. They look at the calendar. They vet it. I also meet with Seacoast Educational Association. I vet this calendar with them. They give me their input. And Professional Development Committee was the other committee that we met with, because they're responsible for providing the training during the days. They had a chance to look at the calendar. So I'm going to recommend this calendar to you. It's pretty simple. No changes except for one minor change. The teachers asked if we could move the workshop day up to September 29th. We've normally had it at the end of October. And the reason they did that is they felt like with new initiatives, having a day early on in the year would give them a chance to really have a day to get training or whatever relative to that initiative. I thought it made good sense. And so we moved it up to the 29th. of September from what we've been doing is the end of October. And plus, we wanted to stay away from Halloween a little bit, so I think this will work out for everyone. Same vacation last week in February, as well as the last week in April, last full week in April. There are four release days, two in on a Wednesday, two on a Friday, which was what we agreed upon with parents. And we tentatively have our last day without snow days. Last day without snow days as June 14th for the kids. And that represents 182 days of instruction.
Do we have to move to accept this?
I would like you to do that.
Andrea?
I have a comment.
Yes?
I was wondering if it would be advantageous on the April 20th and February 23rd to make those early release days in order to get the students out, but have teachers still participating in professional development on those particular days, as opposed to maybe having other early release days. Those are days that I think instruction is not as focused because the kids are ready for vacation, and yet the teachers could still participate in some professional development.
So one of them, you're looking at that January 26th, but that's a full day, right? No,
no, that's just a half
early
day.
Release. You're looking at maybe substitute.
I'm looking at the Fridays before the vacations.
Oh.
As I said, students are ready to be out of there, and yet we would still hold teachers, you know, to their contractual hours and use those as early release days in lieu of maybe the other early release days that we have. We could kind of kill two birds with one stone.
Any other comments?
So what you want to do is
take the January 26th
and put that into
the Friday before February vacation. Is that what you're trying to do?
Okay,
I mean
that.
When you say in lieu of, that's what I was trying to.
Well, as I said, I think that students on the days, the Friday before each of the vacation days, the students are ready to get out. They're ready to go.
But isn't that true when you go a week before Christmas?
Well, we have that already. That's already that December 22nd is already an early release day.
Only for everyone.
That's for everyone.
Okay, but I'm just talking about the students for the Friday before those two, just to get them out of the way, give the teachers time on those days to do their early release, as opposed to, I mean, obviously I would love it if we could do them all, but maybe have those 2 days, get the students out of there and give the teachers time for their professional development then, and not have to interrupt January 26th and maybe the March 28th. Is that a full day?
But if I was a teacher, okay, and I'm not.
Get the same.
Thank God. And it's to start before the vacation.
You're in the same position the kids
I'm
are.
I'm in the same position as the kids are.
Absolutely.
I want to get out because I got to pack and get ready to go. So does it really make a difference?
No. Well, then I would say make April 20th and February 23rd early release days for students.
I'd like to get, Kathleen, can we get your input on that?
Well, obviously, we need the release days for the teachers because that's valuable time. Mm-hmm. I hear what Andrea wants. My problem with it that is getting people to come to Hampton to do workshops on a Friday afternoon
before the holidays,
and that's challenging for us. And we do bring a lot of people in. We bring. I mean, I just talked to you about people that we brought in our workshop. I mean, we're always bringing in, and like, for instance, Lois is doing a math training. Those are days that we bring a trainer in to continue the training with the teachers. So I'm concerned that I might not be able to get people to come in on those days, but I don't know that either, so I think that from a teacher point of view, I think that teachers are ready for a holiday. They'll work with the kids. It's more difficult to do a workshop and a training exercise knowing that they're ready to hop on a plane or whatever. And I want to be positive here because they work awfully hard here. And I want to be positive. But when the holiday, the day before vacation, they have their kids, they do a lot of activities, and they're all gone by 3 o'clock. You know, I mean, it's... So I'm...
And you can walk out the door with the kids.
Yeah.
I have a question. You've already had a meet and confer.
Yeah, I have.
And so you would have to go back, I'm guessing.
Right.
Okay.
I mean, I would want to give them that courtesy, that's all.
Sure.
I mean, I would just... I try to do that with the Teachers Association as well as the leadership team. I don't know what's on their mind.
Any other discussion? Looking for a motion one way or the other? Gonna have a motion one way or the other, folks.
I make a motion to accept the calendar with whether we keep the other early release days or not, having an early release day on the 23rd and the 20th. 23rd of February and the 20th of April.
Second.
If you make the motion and you pass it, then it's done. I don't go back. I just want to be aware of that.
Did we... Okay, can I...
Well, I'm just looking for a second.
Oh.
What about conferences in March? Can we agree upon that?
That's a great point, Lois. I forgot about that. The 28th work release half day is an afternoon where teachers have parent conferences because that's how the trimesters roll out. So I have to keep that one. I can't use the 23rd in lieu of that because I have to have the 28th because teachers use that afternoon for parent conferences.
March 28th.
March 28th, right. Thanks, Lois. I forgot that piece.
Okay, we've had a motion that was made and there was no second. Looking for another motion.
Motion to accept the calendar as it is presented.
Move to accept. Looking for a second.
I'll second it.
Seconded by Frank. Any discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? Passes 3-2. Okay. Financials, anything?
The majority of our conversation has been about budget. We'll finish that tonight. The financial report is much closer with regard to payroll and benefits. Obviously, there's a lot of consumption that still hasn't happened in the supply lines and the like, the discretionary lines. Food service, you have a statement this time. Federal grants are there. I just wanted to make sure that the superintendent already said it, but make sure everybody's aware we're in front of the budget committee on December 8th. We have posted it as the 20th once upon a time, but it is Thursday night the 8th at 7. Excited, we haven't hit benefits yet in the budget. We'll hit that tonight, but our guaranteed maximum rates from Health Trust came in, and we are going to experience a zero change in rates for dental, so no increase in dental, and health insurance came in at a guaranteed maximum of 1.7%. And you'll see when we get to the budget that this year our budget ended up higher than what our actual came in, and there's enough leftover so that we can eat the 1.7% increase in the budget and still make about a $3,000 cut in the health insurance line. We don't very often see that opportunity. So, other than that, any questions?
So, a little bit of kudos here for the staff and for the work that's been done to try to manage this health insurance issue. You know, the teachers, they and the staff, all the staff, I mean, this is custodians, everyone who has health insurance has really embraced the notion of wellness and taking control of their own health and helping to reduce claims. And as a result, the district had the lowest rate in the state for an increase. You know, when you think about it, last year you had a 10% increase in your health costs. So for us to come in at 1.7 as a school district and covering all of our employees was an incredible feat for them. And I have to give kudos to the staff, the entire staff, for their efforts to try to help us in terms of that. And so, as Nathan said, we're going to see a decrease in the budget for next year just because of the way it rolls out. And that's pretty special, given the issues that we all face around health insurance. The average, by the way, for the state this year, all the other school districts in the state, was 13%. Some went as high as 30, and obviously we had the low at 1.7. So that's
okay. Committee reports. Budget committee, anything?
Nothing.
Let's see, recreation department, Pepper?
Nope, they're meeting as we speak. Jay's up there representing us, just, you know, the clock tower, you know, the time, but okay. That's coming up Sunday. Nope, nothing yet.
While we have you, professional development, anything?
I haven't been at a meeting.
We have a meeting coming up, okay. A full-day meeting to redo our plan, which is due at the end of the month. That's so correct. That's on your calendar,
yep,
right?
Sorry.
Curriculum, Andrew?
I met with the social studies group, and we have an upcoming meeting with the science group, and they're all working very hard toward, the goals that they've set for themselves, and meeting with specialists to unpack the 3C, and so we'll just continue doing that.
Okay. New Hampshire School Board Association, I really have nothing from them. CIP, who reports on CIP?
I guess I could offer it up. Well, you voted the CIP in at a recent meeting, and we forwarded that along to the CIP committee. It's a statutory process that supports having an impact fee ordinance, among other things, as a part of the master plan. So we've sent that along, and we'll see that CIP come out from the town side at some point, but that's it for our process until next year.
Okay. Moving right along. Do you want to do the motions?
Mm-hmm. That'd be great. So I would ask that the board accept the resignation of Jackie Savarni. Jackie fulfilled a part-time reading position at Hampton Academy.
Moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Right.
Is this the reading specialist we hired?
Yes.
And we just lost her?
Yes.
And what was the rule? And how are we filling
letter,
the position?
The letter is yes. Actually, interviewed a candidate today with a degree from UNH in reading, and she's a reading and writing specialist. So I interviewed her today. She's been interviewed by David and his team at Hampton Academy, and Dave's finishing up the process of checking references. Mrs. Silvani's letter of resignation is in your packet on page 13.
Who do we have in there now?
Sub.
But this was October 14th. It's a month later.
Well, we had trouble finding somebody to fill the position.
Well, my question is, we had a meeting, what, last week?
It was a budget meeting. I suppose I could have brought that. I didn't bring it to a work session. I suppose I could have, but I...
Okay. And we have a reading specialist.
We have a reading writing specialist with a master's degree from the university.
Is she looking for full-time or part-time?
She's looking for part-time. If I, after I complete the process of checking references, I will have that for you. I'm hoping that I'll have it for you at your meeting next Wednesday.
So there's a possibility then we can convert the position back to full-time, if she's full-time.
She's part-time.
I mean, she's part-time, but...
But don't we already have another part-time
person? We have another part-time person who's under contract for part-time.
Part-time person, but the part-time person isn't certified as a
reading specialist.
Thank you. Reading specialist.
She has a contract, right?
Right.
Is there a possibility of taking the person who is part-time with a contract, putting them into something else, and getting this person full-time?
I don't know. When we advertised and when we interviewed, it was for a part-time position.
Okay.
Should it work out, things work out, then I would be most interested in, well, as I've said all along, we want a full-time position.
So that's something you would look at.
Right.
Awesome.
Right. Okay. We've sort of all agreed to that we wanted a full-time person with a reading specialist license in that position.
And what are we looking at? I don't know if this is, do we go into non-pub or when we talk dollars?
Well, no, we don't need to do that, but I'm not ready to nominate her yet.
Okay,
so if you could just give
all
me
right.
a little
so
more time. There's no offers have been made. You know, I just want you to know that I did interview somebody, that there is somebody that we feel is very qualified, and we just need to finish the process.
Okay.
Okay, and I'll have, I'm fairly confident that we'll have it ready for you next week.
Okay.
And in the meantime, we have had a substitute.
Okay.
Okay.
Retirements?
And retirements, you know, you really don't vote on the retirements, but I want to, you know, for purposes of tonight's meeting, just...
Resignation.
Oh, yeah. That's right. We need a motion to accept her resignation.
We've got the motion in the second.
Oh.
We need a vote.
Oh, we just need a vote. All those in favor? 5-0. Thank you, Joan.
And so I bring to you the three, and their letters are in the in your packets, but we've received notice from Mary Ann Moynihan, teacher over at Center, Eileen Lonigan, math teacher at Hampton Academy, and Kathy Adams, a reading teacher that we share between Center and Marston, have all submitted notice of their retirement.
Okay, we motion to accept.
Motion to accept.
Okay, second. Any discussion? Should we accept
these? I think we accept these with regret.
With regret.
So thank you, because I will send them a letter on your behalf indicating that you discussed it tonight and that you accepted. And you really can't say no. I mean, you say
no,
you accept it, right?
No,
but you're just... No, I know you're not saying no, but...
Sincere regret because we're losing some very talented
yes,
people
we are.
That have given
people that have worked very hard.
Many years of service to our district, and it will be sad to see them.
Yeah, in those three positions is well over almost 60 years of service to the district.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Yeah, didn't forget that. Okay. Policy review. JLC, Student Health Services, first read.
Just let me go to him.
Any discussions? First read.
Can I jump in?
Sure.
Andrea, can I jump in?
Yeah, oh yeah.
The recommendations for this policy, I worked with the school nurses, so they developed it. They took the policy that was in, that was current, and just kind of cleaned it up and took out some things that are no longer applicable and created this policy.
Okay. And then concussions and head injuries. You guys made a lot of changes to those. Now, we'll
be voting on this one.
Yeah, again, this was developed by our school nurse at Hampton Academy, Karen Brand, along with Ellen Morissette, in collaboration with Carol Dozebrin at Winneconnet High School. And so this is a kind of cleaned up from the last policy and more specific around the requirements and responsibilities around youngsters with head injuries. As you know, we continue to do the impact testing in grade 7, so every student at Hampton Academy has a, with permission from parent, has an impact test, which gives the doctors a baseline for any head injury. It's been valuable. I talked to Karen, and we've had a couple of youngsters who have had head injuries playing sports. Sometimes it's outside of school, too. You know, we actually talked with some of the coaches in town, and they were thrilled that we did this because that helps them to monitor the youngsters who are playing, like, football and soccer and other sports, cheerleading, which, you know, they're flipping in the air. And so this cleans up the language and works nicely into the work that they do at the high school.
Motion?
I make a motion to accept.
Moved, Andrea. Seconded, Frank. Any further discussion? Okay, we have a motion to accept this policy. All those in favor? Unanimous. Okay. Yes. Yes.
One of the things that is in your packet tonight is on enrollment. Just know that we continue to monitor it. We saw an uptick from October to November. We added another 10 students. We think we'll be back to our June numbers by over the next couple of months. We've had a number of registrations. The buildings have been busy, along with the school counselors and other folks that work on these enrollments, registrations. So just to give you an idea, I mean, the numbers aren't way off from last month, but you add one here all the way up through the grade levels, and you see the greatest jump was probably in preschool, where we identified more. We have four friendship youngsters and 15 youngsters that are in our preschool program.
Okay, I think we're moving on to minutes of October 11th. Anybody want to make a motion?
Make a motion to accept.
Move to accept. Pepper?
Second.
Second, Andrea. Ready to vote? All those in favor? Opposed? None. Unanimous. I have no correspondence.
None.
Do you have any manifests to sign?
No, we're good. We got them all signed?
I think we've talked about some of the things that are going to be happening in November and December. Any new business? Any other?
I'd like to, at our original meeting in September, we talked about enrollment in schools and classroom sizes. You were supposed to get back to us on those particular classes, i.e. algebra.
I did.
Oh.
You got a report back in September, October?
October?
Yeah.
I don't recall that, but okay. Mm-hmm.
I'll be happy to run another report.
No. No.
Be happy.
But did we lose some people in algebra?
Dave can help me with that. Dave, can you help me with the numbers in algebra? I haven't looked at it, Frank, in a bit since I did that first report.
There's 25 students in the class, and two of them are seventh graders. Normally we would add 23 eighth graders, but we had two very, very good seventh grade students, so we moved them up. So there's 25 students in there, and the class is running well. It's if you break that into two classes, though, it would just be too small, I believe. But we're monitoring it. I don't believe there's an issue. And if there was, I would come to the superintendent immediately and let her know.
Okay.
Any other Other? Okay. Seeing as there's no any other others, move to adjourn.
I make a motion to adjourn.
Seconded?
Second.
Pepper? All those in favor? Okay. We are done at 6:03.
Nine.
We'll call it 6:10.
Okay.
Call this meeting to order at 6:10. I guess we should have the Pledge of Allegiance. Second meeting.
Do you good?
Pledge of Allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
In the Star Spangled Banner now?
Maybe we all should after last night, Frank.
Let's not talk about last night.
Okay, so we left off. Does somebody have it marked?
2400.
2400,
yep.
Let me, if I may, just draw your attention to the packet I just handed you. Bummer. I have a spelling error and I didn't get it fixed. Hopefully this isn't prime time, right? This is just formality, but I wanted to make sure that I gave you documents that you could stick into your budget book to keep track of what we did. So the cover page essentially reminds us that at our last meeting, we adjusted these pages, right? And I gave you just a brief description. We added tech summer salaries. We adjusted the school board stipends. We addressed, put a placeholder in for the budgeted increase of the superintendent. We eliminated the HR assistant / communications position that we were talking about. And then there were some benefits updates. And so in each case where there was a financial change, you got the summary page at the beginning of that function, and you also got the detail page. So that in there, you've got some pages, the three-hole punch, they can go right back into each section and replace. It's probably premature, depending on what happens, but there's a summary in there as well. And then for any point tonight, you're ready to have some conversation. I got some data together for the LPN conversation, because we talked about pricing. So I pulled from the Department of the Department of Administrative Services of the state of New Hampshire. I went in and I pulled out the job descriptions for LPN 1 and LPN 2 to give us some background, and then pulled their salary scales to get a sense of what the state's hiring. I say in the notes, the state certainly isn't the only benchmark, and maybe isn't the best benchmark, but...
No, I think, did you get private sector?
No, but I'm... So there's a scale right there that tells you how the state would hire. Private sector, I'll call some private nursing homes if you want and ask them how much it'll take to hire away their people. The state's probably a cheapskate when it comes to hiring, but there's some rates for your consideration, and we can set rates anywhere in that range, really. But I was just trying to come up with something that was defensible and measurable.
I understand that, but to benefit the state, they do offer packages, you know, so where they don't give it to you monetarily in some cases. I'm talking about full-time positions.
Right.
They make it up in the retirement plan or whatever. I mean, with a good retirement plan, health benefits, et cetera, et cetera. So that's the balancing act versus the private.
Well, in this case, we're talking about a part-time position that's like six and a half hours a day, school year only.
One of the other concerns I had with the nurse, I have to be very careful. You know, we have nurses employed in our district full-time, absolutely. So I want to be very careful that, you know, and trying to compete with the private sector, and what was the rate per hour versus the rate per hour of our nurses. So I was a little worried about that. I asked Nathan to, you know, to know that, that I was sensitive to that.
Yeah.
And I know you are, too.
I would say the same thing,
So just more data in there, something that we could work on, because we talked about that.
And my other comment was, if I remember that budget meeting last week, we did defer discussion on... non-union,
mm-hmm.
Okay, because that's where the increase is, because we were going to look at that, okay?
You've got a whole page where they're all, the only one that I didn't update that page, the one number that's not on there is the increase that you voted on last time for the superintendent's placeholder for next year.
Okay,
2400. School administration, and those are the principals and assistant principals.
So I've got a plugged in 2% there, like is reflected in Frank was just talking about on that summary page. No staffing changes otherwise there, and these reflect the current positions and people. Secretaries follow suit on the second page. Both the principal secretary and school secretary / attendant secretary in each of the three buildings. Page 4, course reimbursements. The arrangement in your administrative contracts provide for course reimbursement with the approval of the superintendent and budget support at the UNH rate. This certainly wouldn't cover all of the covered administrators if they were all going, but we think it's going to be a good dollar amount to chase the anticipated course reimbursement consumption. You've got assistant principals in two buildings that are moving and grooving, so we anticipate that some of that may be used over the next couple of years.
Can I ask you, what was the increase that we budgeted for them for what, this current year? Wasn't it 1.5?
It was really it was fractured. It was 1.5 that we talked about coming into the budget process. We approved 2.5 for a number of administrative positions in an initial conversation, and then subsequently we did.
But we did that to offset benefits.
The loss of.
Yep. Right? The health thing. That's why we did that.
That's right.
Okay. I'm just concerned that, I guess we can talk about it now, instead of waiting, because we pushed it from last week to this week. I'm just concerned, and I'm just throwing this out on the table, that 2% might be too absorbent, you know. I think maybe we should scale back to 1.5. The only reason I'm saying that is you're presenting a school program, the new school, to the voters, and then we're jumping non-contractual people 2%. You know, and I think if we look prudent on this, based on what we did last year,
1.75.
You know, I think, and inflation didn't jump in that much, and I think, I don't even know if Social Security's going up.
Teeny bit.
1.75.
A little bit. 1.5 maybe.
1.5 in the step.
So maybe that's what we should move everything. That's my rationale. Move it 1.5. Now, I know it, that half percent doesn't mean much, but I think it's a... It looks like we're prudent, and we're looking at this in the relationship that we're bringing in this school. That's my opinion.
Okay, Frank, just so I understand, you're not talking just about, these secretaries. You're talking about any of the 2% across the board.
Anything going down to 1.5. And what would be the half-point cost?
What did the teachers get?
I can pull that up. I guess that's not in the graphic that I gave you. So I can tell you what that would be in just a couple of minutes. Important, I guess I could share with you. Remember that the teachers are at 1.75 off the top of the grid. The paras were working with essentially a similar number when they negotiated 2 years back. And I put CPI, the Consumer Price Index, which is the metric that's used in a lot of our regional collective bargaining agreements to chase some measure of what the economy is doing. That's under your info tab.
What's that?
Well, it's the most recent reading was 2.3. I don't think that the 12-month average is going to be as high as that.
No, it's going to be around 1.4, 1.5.
It'll land in the middle ones probably.
Yeah.
You can look and see the last six metrics, you know, the last six releases. They release every 2 months on the CPI that we use.
So any other discussion on whether it should be two?
Well, I'd like to know how much the difference is.
Oh.
I mean, if you're going to make a decision on it, we should know what
the cost. Well, he's going to have to cost out quite a few pages, I'm guessing. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I can do it. I've got a version of that. I just need to double check, make sure that the numbers are right. That'll take me a couple of minutes. So,
okay.
If you want to, I'll work on that while we're while we're going. If you want to keep going through some detail, okay. And I'll bring that to
you. Do that. I can.
Yeah.
So, course reimbursement. We looked at that. Workshops, seminars. I'm sure that gets used.
Is it enough?
Well, I added to Andrea and okay. Really covers it.
Okay, just making sure.
Yep. No, okay. I feel good about it. Okay.
Telephone.
You know, you can see that your actuals are lower than what we're budgeting, but we've been using E-rate reimbursements to knock that down and refund some of that each year. This cycle and the next, Greg's chasing all the E-rate into fiber and some of the bandwidth, which is where E-rate, USAC, the Universal Schools and Libraries, however that organization is titled, they're really driving us away from telecom now and more into bandwidth and internet access. So I'm leaving the budget in this proposal flat because I think we're going to see less of the offset from E-rate and we're going to need this budget to cover. Our real costs, you can see, are listed there, so we're only seeing 14 and 13 as a result of the refunds from E-rate.
Postage, that's pretty steady.
Yeah.
Their supplies are essentially flat.
Level funded, pretty much.
Yeah. The dues went up a little bit just to compensate for a $10 increase in the four of them, so. Five of them, right? Maybe five.
Do I have a motion to accept the 2400 account as presented?
We're going to come back to that. We'll have to go back to a lot of accounts.
I think you can pervasive, unless you want to break them up, do them separately, if you just want to make a decision.
I think Andrea's right. I think we should just accept it with the understanding we're coming back to the salary increases in general.
Because there's a lot of accounts here that we're going to have to go back to that we've accepted.
Well,
so
I make a motion to accept it conditionally upon...
Well, accept it.
All right. I'll second that.
Okay. All those in favor? Pepper? Yeah?
No, I have opposed it.
Okay.
Who was the motion? I'm sorry.
You got Andrea.
Andrea.
Who seconded?
Frank, I think.
Thank you. So, I've got your... 0.1%. 0.1 is without rolling in FICA, it's $1,941. So
throughout the whole budget,
throughout all of the people that are relevant,
and then that's 0.1%.
So 1% would be 10 times that'd be 19,410.
So we're looking at 0.5%,
which would be
1,000, just round it for the sake of argument.
1, yeah, I can.
950 if you really want to be.
This times 5 is $9,703. Is 0.5%. And if you multiply, you want to roll 9, that up.
9,700.
Yep, $9,700.
Okay.
Call it 10 grand when you add in FICA, because that salary has got some taxes attached to it.
So that's 10.
Yep.
So 10,000, and how many people are we looking at?
Hold on. It's right around 38, I think.
380,000.
No. This is not 10,000 for all of them. Oh. Everybody in the whole district that's affected by that 2% or what have you.
Okay.
The savings of cutting from, for instance, 2% to 1.5% would save you about 10 grand on what's proposed.
So I understand that the principal salary may have triggered that thinking, but I want you to remember that this includes secretaries, custodians, our food service workers, just in our monitors, the monitors are covered by the CBA, right? I'm sorry. But those folks are also covered, custodians, secretaries, food service people.
That makes it a little
and bad. Then the principals and the administratives in... in the SAU.
35 people. It includes, as just listed, all of the administrators, the secretaries, two at each building, plus two in special ed, the social worker, the technology team of 4 people, and 11 custodians. 37. Sorry, there's 13 custodians.
Did you include this food service?
Out of the 37, how much is the gross dollar amount?
2.27 million, 2,274,000. Well, I'm exaggerating a little bit because that includes the substitutes and some other accounts. So,
They're not getting the 2%. So.
Yeah. No. Let me just give me 30 seconds.
$1,940,000.
Well, that's it, right? So 0.1% was
$1,940,000. Okay.
Should have thought of that. That would have made my math easier. 1% is $19,004.
So we're looking at 10.
For the majority of the lowest paid people on the total pool.
I can't do that. All right, let's just leave it alone.
Do we have to rescind our motion?
No.
No, you supported the...
We supported it.
I think you're set up... The kind of what I took the intent to be was we were supportive all the way through, but at some point you needed to have a capstone conversation about is 2% a number to be used throughout, or do you want to adjust that? And if you adjusted it, we could do a wholesale and go back and adjust it everywhere.
Yeah.
Okay.
But the adjustment isn't worth the...
Buildings. 2622.
We should go page by page, but if you look at the very first page first, the colorful one with the columns, let me just draw your attention. In the default, there are two things that change. And I guess part of this, I want to explain to you that Mr. Lessard's budget is it's the most contingency-based of the budget, right? Repair and maintenance is a big line item, but that's based upon what comes up, what needs to be fixed, what needs to be dealt with. In the default, there are two things changing. One is we're increasing water to match what the rates have done and what our costs are. We're increasing that by $1,350. We'll touch that again when we get there. And then property and liability insurance is budgeted up by $4,476. That's a 9% cap. We're in a cap program, a three-year budgetary product, if you want to call it that, where they guarantee us that we won't see an increase of more than 9%. They haven't given us what our actual will be, so I'm budgeting for the 9. So those are the two things that change in the default. And in the proposed, three things change. Keith's salary, custodial salaries, and fire protection, we've dropped $1,000. The rest of it is flat, and it's a good graphic, you know, to be able to visually see that there's not a lot of change proposed in his budget right now. But having said that, we can walk through.
Can I ask you on that page?
Yeah, please.
Is that top one a 3% increase?
It's intended to be a 2, but so Frank mentioned it earlier. We had only budgeted for a 1.5% increase in the last cycle, but the board opted with a number of positions to, in response to the changes in health insurance, to increase 2.5, not 1.5, so we didn't have as much money in those lines as we needed. So picking up last year's increase and the 2%, that's what the 3 represents.
Got it.
Yep. Because of the health situation last year, and you weren't part of because you just came in the middle of it, the administrative staffs were going to pick up a size, with their, we were giving them a 1.5, 2% raise.
1.5, yeah.
1.5, okay. And it would just basically, the increases in health care would just chew it up the whole thing. Yeah. So they would, in fact, in some cases, it felt they would lose money in their paycheck. So that's why we all agreed to bump it to the 2.5 to offset that increase.
Okay.
So they came out whole.
Okay. If you went back and looked in a couple of other line items, you'll see that as well, because there were multiple positions where that happened. We had actually only budgeted sufficient dollars in the line item for principals. So there's the facilities manager on page 2. The salary is split between the three buildings just for allocation purposes. Page 3, we continue to carry, we use some of these dollars every year in some support services for Keith. We haven't been using the total amount, but we keep seeing the possibility of it. And this is for some clerical support and some pick-me-up kind of handyman kind of help once in a while. Mr. Lessard, we don't really have a maintenance staff, so that which the custodians can't do, Keith takes a swing at before he hires in a vendor on contract. So small dollars that help plug some holes. Custodians are on page 4. Oh, I was right. It is 11. 4, no 5. 4, 4, and 3. Substitutes on page 6, page 5, have you?
Sorry. Questions? I had a question on 2624. When does longevity kick in for the custodians?
It's the same as for the other non-union support staff, he says as he tries to get to it. After 10 years.
So there's 3 tiers, 10?
They have 4 tiers, 10, 14, 18, and 22. Huh. That, for sake of discussion, has not changed since we started. the tiers haven't changed, but the dollars also have not changed. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if, I guess I could say it. I don't know in 21 if every year there's a 1.5% or 2% growth in salary scales, if the longevity gets a bump as well. We haven't been doing that. So it's something that another cycle we might want to look back and say, well, what is longevity? How does it apply? What's its basis? And should it be adjusted, corrected, or revised? It's in your info tab as well. It's on the back of the proposed hourly rate schedule for support staff.
So if that was going to get changed, you folks would have to bring it to us. There's no negotiations.
No negotiations.
Just bring it to us.
You could change it anytime. Yeah.
We
inform them. I'd inform the staff and.
If it hasn't changed for a number of years, maybe perhaps next year.
Yeah, I think another cycle. I don't look at it that often, other than to plug it in and roll. But I think it's worth considering.
Why not this year?
Well, I think our underlying goal here is to keep things down. I don't want to nickel and dime someone either, but I think next year they'll have a chance to study going into it and give it some thought.
One of the things I should do probably is compare what the longevity is. We also have different categories. Not only do we have the four tiers, but then we have a longevity rate for 12-month employees, school year employees, and some, there's one in between too. There's three. So it's a multi-tiered system, and we ought to consider what it is as a percentage of salary, how it compares from tier to tier. If I'm not sure, I'll call Paula too and find out if she remembers the rationale behind its inception, because maybe there was an intent that it was to be a 2%, award at some point or what. I'll do the homework. I'll look into that for the next cycle to ask and find out.
Is it different for each class?
No, not the custodians, secretaries, technology team, food service. They're all in the same category. Yeah, and that's one of the other things, because their hourly rate structures are different, but their longevity number comes off the same scale. Although, secretaries, we have two categories. We have 12-month secretaries, and then we have school year secretaries. So that's two different rates. But the 12-month secretary and the 12-month custodian are seeing the same longevity opportunity. And like I said, it's in the it's under the info tab. It's there if you wanted to look through that scale. But I just hadn't. I've reflected each year that there's no change. But it's. I guess I never really thought much about. We do now have more and more people, and of course some of them fit. You're looking at numbers here with the custodians, that are 12-month numbers, and they are long-time employees. You know, they've hit the 22-year mark, a number of them. So,
okay.
Custodian subs on page 5. We've had more use of that in the last couple of, the last year. But that number has been pretty flat as long as I've been here. Custodial overtime, we have bumped up a number of times to try to meet the after school, the snow load, the overtime over the weekends. The biggest consumption of that is the community-based organizations who we don't charge fees to for use of the buildings, but we do have custodial oversight, and we staff the building to unlock and then relock and check security and be available to them as a resource for safety and cleanliness and you name it. So that and the snow, when the snow hits, that's what drives the overtime.
Well, let me ask you a question. I understand the snow situation.
Yeah.
No question there. But when we have the youth of our facility, why can't we charge them?
You've got a policy, and we can revisit the policy. But the policy speaks to some categories that we do charge. And yes. So we do recoup some of them. But when it's the HYA or the rec department or you name it, when they're using our facilities, we're not charging those groups.
Okay.
So there are charges that we don't see in our budget that the town picks up. For instance, when they pick up our trash, there's no cost. You have no trash cost. Okay. So you see, we kind of do a tit for tat,
There's no charge when they pick up my trash except in the tax structure.
Well, right, but we don't pay that, so it's a free service for us. They also come in on snow days, and the big plows from the town come down Marston, around the circle, and through the parking lot. So I'm feeling like we get a good, you know, we get something back for the use of the facility. I just want you to know that. Yeah, no, I appreciate that.
It's also, I think, I should just tell you, this is... Oh, after a while, this becomes part of the compensation package. I mean, our staff expect they're on a rotating cycle to have building security responsibility, and on the weekends they have to come in and do building checks. Even if nobody's using the building, right, they have to do building checks. That's beyond their 40 hours. That's at overtime, and so they know that on the cycle they're going to have that opportunity. And I'm not looking to work people extra hours, but the reality is, this is all our people. Like, these aren't subs being hired in picking up OT. These are our people coming in to pick up additional hours. And so if for instance we said, well, we don't want to do this anymore, that's a direct impact on our custodial staff, because this is really part of their annual earnings.
We need to do it.
We need to do it
because who's going to remove the snow?
Oh, yeah, no, these guys, we got a great crew, so we're really lucky. No.
Okay.
On water expense, you can see I literally went through and picked up each of the accounts and ran the numbers on how they go. And that's where I got this budget that's, in this case, now $1,350 or $1,320 more than past year. There have been some increases, and you can see that in the actuals over the 14-15 to 15-16 year.
Just curious, why is the Academy's backflow test cheaper than the other two?
It's a great question. I didn't ask that of Keith when I put that in, but I pulled it off the bill working a couple of years running. It could be because the backflow test is not one test. Yeah. That's multiple. So as I look at it, it may be that it's because there aren't as many meters to test.
Yeah. Well, the same in the fire service.
There's a whole account. There's a whole account missing. There's a whole one account less because of the way that the service at the Academy is laid up.
Yeah, I'm sure there's a reason. And Center and Marston have two water.
They have two service meters instead
and
of one.
And just has one.
Right.
Okay, recycling.
Although, for what it's worth, if you look at the two water services at Marston, 25 and 3, they're combined less water and less cost than the one at Hampton Academy. So,
right. Recycling. That's just a placeholder.
It's a placeholder. The town has been picking up our recycling and our rubbish. Pest control is essentially a placeholder. I mean, it's. He does it when he needs to, as he needs to. This is really just in the buildings, because our kind of tick control, we haven't talked much about mosquitoes in the last couple of years, but the ticks have been an issue, and that's part of grounds. Fire safety on page 10 was, we had a big spike. And another cycle, I think Keith and I may come back and suggest we can cut some of this. We were finding that everything that we needed to do had to go through a fire safety engineer, that the local fire department wasn't comfortable, as they had been in previous cycles, taking some things at face value and making some of their own decisions. They were looking for an engineer to really help them out with some of the... I mean, the classic example was when we put the tent out on the lawn for the Hampton Academy celebration, we had to have a fire safety engineer lay out the chairs and a safety plan and exits from a tent, which didn't have doors or walls, but... And so our costs, you can look in 14-15, went up. They were over 20 grand. So we bumped this up. The individual we're working with now has been easier to deal with in those.
What's the fire suppression system we work with?
Our actual sprinkler system, multiple parts at different buildings. Carter sprinkler, John L. Carter sprinkler.
And who does most of? Who does like the fire extinguishers and all that sort of stuff? Is that Carter?
No.
The name
escapes me, but Keith will text me. He's at home watching. He'll hit me up.
That's all.
He'll
curious.
Text me the name. I don't remember.
I forget who does it.
Yeah, I see it go by. But
I see the invoices.
He has.
Okay.
Yeah, not every year, but he has before.
Okay.
So, but really, for what it's worth, if you look at the actuals under 15, 16, that's more in line with what it was back in 11, 12, 12, 13 even. It was 13, 14, and 14, 15 where we really saw a spike. Couldn't have an assembly in the gym without zip tying all of the chairs together, and we had the fire engineer do us a layout for where chairs would go and where people could sit and where the... So we went through a lot of those things, and we had bumped the budget up for that. So I dropped 1,000 off it with Keith's blessing, but I think another cycle we may be able to shave more. Repair and maintenance stayed flat. This is the big account. This is... you'll see actuals that are beyond what we're budgeting, but that's because this is also the account where so often when we do projects in May, June, based upon some of the anticipated fund balance, this is where it gets charged. So those actuals are project driven, not just, you know, regular routine maintenance driven.
Can we go back to pest control? You said ticks and stuff like that.
So ticks, we actually deal with ticks, like in the fields and
yeah.
And the property line. We deal with that in the mowing and grounds account, which is coming up next.
Oh, okay. Because I was going to ask you about mosquitoes.
God, yep. I didn't ask him. We didn't talk about it. I mosquitoes. We've been lucky the last couple of cycles that mosquoitoes haven't been the same concern that they had been.
Zika virus,
right.
and it has spread. I mean, it's a big issue in Florida. They have found some traces of it this summer in Massachusetts, and I think on the Cape. So it is starting to move up, and I'm just concerned. You got kids in the field doing after-school sports. You know, you got teachers out there, and I know it has an impact on mothers that are expecting. Yeah, that's been a proven fact, so I don't know. So
let's talk over the winter. I mean, obviously we're pretty close to frost now, and you know, we're beyond it for the fall.
I'm looking at the spring.
But for the spring, let's, as snow flies here in the next couple of months, let me get Keith to get us to an update on what we've been doing.
Yeah.
With regard to ticks, and we were talking about mosquitoes a lot three years ago. Mm-hmm. Let me ask
so
him where we've been with that, and then talk about what we're going to do for the spring so that the board can be aware of that. Bring it back up.
Yeah.
I'll ask him to update us on where we're at, what we do. Property liability on page 12. I don't know yet, but I know that last year the increase was pretty consistent with the cap. So I've budgeted for the 9% cap. Keith's supplies are really his cleaning supplies, his floor strippers and refinishers, the pads, et cetera, for his buffers. If you happen to tie this back to your financials, he does a lot of his supply buying in the spring, April, May, because he's getting ready. He ramps up. He uses through the year what he has, but in the spring he buys. Then he has new chemicals clean and ready, and that's the stuff that he uses for the big housekeeping sweep through the summer months. The next two pages, 14 and 15, electricity and natural gas. We've done really well with electricity and with gas in the competitive market, locking them down. Here's what I'll tell you. I've left the budgets flat. In the area of electricity, people have talked about some increases that they have seen. We are locked down through December of 17, but we're exposed on January 1st through January something through June of that the year we're budgeting for. But I don't see that our consumption is changing dramatically, so I've got 6 months of a rate that's exposed, and between the actuals in 15-16 and the proposed budget, or the current budget, I've got about $14,000 of room to adjust for any increase that might happen when I go back out and negotiate for another, you know, I bid out for another another cycle or two. So
you're confident?
I think I've got plenty there to do. That's good. On the next page, we can come back to, but on the next page, gas, which is a lot more volatile, you can look back at 14-15 and see that we were up close to 200,000, but in 15-16 we were 90% of that, you know, half of that. I'm locked out there through this heating season, but not the one I'm budgeting for. I'm getting right now to that time and place where we'll start to chase the market and see if we can negotiate. But again, if you take what I did last year, assume an increase into the current year, and then assume another increase into next year, I've got almost $30,000 to work with, and I think that that's okay. I haven't shaved this budget because I don't know for sure, but I've left it flat so that there's no budget increase there. And if the if geopolitical concerns, if the stock market impacts of last night and today, it, looking at what's coming and not knowing, I could be back. I mean, this is essentially all the same consumption. So if you look at 14-15 at almost 200, and you look at last 15-16 at half that, that's the same amount basically. 14-15 was a deeper winter. It was a colder winter. We had all that snow. So obviously there was a little bit more in consumption because it was colder. But I'm not finding in the numbers that I'm looking at that those kinds of trends make huge swings. It certainly didn't explain almost a doubling or a half of that. That was because of what the market rate was that we were paying for gas. So anyway, that's all of that is to say, I think I'm okay here. If you wanted to shave some, I think we could, not electricity, but in gas. Well, but I don't know what I'm going to chase when I go out and negotiate. So,
at each school, you can use either gas or oil.
I'm dual fuel, and we can bounce back and forth.
What do you use most of?
Mostly gas. Gas is the better burning. It's the more economical fuel. But
you got to burn some oil.
We burned some. Keith burned some to keep the burners going. And the other thing that we did, give me just 1 second, because you maybe weren't here. You weren't here for the conversation, and maybe it never got back to you. But we went 2 years where we bought, we played the market. So on the days when the market price spiked, by 10 o'clock, Keith, we'd get the call, and Keith would flip the burners all to oil. We'd burn off the oil tanks, and then all the gas that we had bought, contracted for, we would sell it on the open market. When we were in at 10, we were in at 10 cents, or we were in at a buck a therm, and it was at 28. We would sell our buck a therm for 28 bucks and make the profits and pull that back in against our accounts. We did well with that for one cycle. We were kind of marginal. We didn't lose, but we didn't really make a lot of money in the second cycle. After that, we locked down because the market changed, and we just didn't. In that last year, we just didn't see those big swings where it would run up for, you know, by 10, 20, 30 bucks. So, in this case, I'm looking to lock down the whole exposure.
So I think 30,000 is a safe.
I do.
Safety net, and it's going to be.
You know, again, if we go to war in the Gulf.
This is a gamble.
But I think this is plenty for the foreseeable, the reasonable conditions that we might face.
And we haven't heard any news of huge spikes. To date.
Okay, we had a mild winter last year, cold but mild. Okay, not the snow.
No snow.
Which was every weekend, school was closed, okay, temperatures dropped below zero. I'm not anticipating a severe winter this year, but I could be mistaken. But that's not to say what's going to happen for this budget cycle.
Right, which is a whole year out, so.
Yeah, that bothers me. So
one of the most difficult things you do every year is trying to forecast what you need, 18 months ahead, right? That's what you're doing, and it's very difficult.
But I go back. I was going to say, I go back to your comments that you've all made a couple of times. We've all talked about. We want to get the project. I'm trying to support that. If we really needed budget savings, I might be able to see some shaving here, although not a lot. But I wasn't going to ask for any more, because here's the other thing: I'll have a chance to go out and be competitive with the bidding and lock down a rate. And if what it looks like is that this year, 17-18, bless you, that we budgeted for, I need 20 or 30,000 I don't have. We have all kinds of time to say, where's it going to come from and how are we going to do that, so that we can make some, you know, some good decisions that won't affect kids any more than they have to. So,
of course, this doesn't reflect all the changes that could occur when we get the renovation.
Right. Some great efficiencies. And
Okay.
Furniture, page 16, is a placeholder for Keith. He tries to use those dollars every year to do inventory turn in the buildings. It's something I think we should probably talk about, look at, and maybe budget for a little more aggressively, you know. But I think he's done well. If you walk through the buildings, student desks and chairs are not in, they're not in bad shape. You know, we've talked about replacing some number of or some percentage of furniture at the academy in a project, but not all of it. Mm-hmm. But what our comment has been, 25% replacement, maybe 75% sticking around, to work through a inventory turn process to replace that over time. 15 grand isn't going to cut that district wide year over year. So that's something I think we can, you know, we'll talk about our technology needs and how quickly technology changes. We should be talking about furniture and looking at that as well.
The smart boards aren't reflected in this.
They're in the technology. This is desks and chairs and students, you know, teacher desks.
Cabinets, bookcases, yep. That kind of thing.
On page 17, we're talking about equipment. This is indoor and outdoor. This is where Keith would stick a snowblower, a push machine out in the yard. This is where he puts his housekeeping machines that are in the buildings. And you can see that one year he's got some over here and some over there. Another year he doesn't spend anything at a building because he's really judicious about that and buys what he has to when he needs to. Staff training is...
Self-explanatory.
So that's...
I'd like to just at this point commend Keith Lessard and his staff, his custodial staff. They do an amazing job given the budget that they have, and we're very, very lucky to have Keith and his staff with us.
Very dedicated.
He works hard and he does a good job.
He's been very important to me and the job that I've had for these years, and I've appreciated having him for sure. You don't get that lucky in every district that you.
Motion for 2620. Frank.
Second.
Andrea second. All those in favor? Unanimous.
The next section combines our grounds and our yards, etc. The first account is where there's some change of note. Excuse me. Our lawn mowing. We actually went out to bid. We've gone out to bid now 2 years running because we were chasing dollars. And the reality is that we came in, and in the first 2 or 3 years, we worked with a budget that was in the... We worked with a contract rate that was in the $16,000, $17,000, $18,000 range. It has clearly jumped up into the 20s. It's the cost of fuel, the labor cost... And we've had now two vendors, local firms, that have been quite honest and said, we can't renew with you at those rates. We've got to go here. We went out to bid, and it proved itself to be true. And so Keith and I are asking to bump this up from the current budget of $21,000 to $27,300 to cover essentially the contract, the bid rate that I have in hand right now for the current cycle. That's lawn mowing. Yep. Grounds repair, we're increasing just, $3,400? Mm-hmm. And that's, again, trying to chase actuals. And the thing that's in grounds repair that is noteworthy, and I really guess intended to put it in here, and I haven't. We are spending each year more and more dollars in support of Batchelder Pond. Out at on Toll Farm Road, and as part of the mowing contract, it gets regular mowing and trimming out there. But it's erosion of the bank and the monies that we've invested in shoring that up. It's combating those ducks and all the stuff that they're doing to it. We've had some great work done by Eagle Scouts in terms of the benches and out back into the bridge out into the property. But this is really at the road frontage where the public appreciates it and enjoys it and trying to preserve and protect it. And you see that in the actuals the last couple of cycles. And so we've bumped the numbers up, and I'll change the narrative to make it reflect that, because that's really the biggest piece. Keith continues to do the best that he can and the right thing as often as he can. The other piece I think that's happening is we're seeing a fair amount of cost involved in tree removal, trimming. We've got some age. I don't know if we always had it, but of the last two or three years, there's been more and more properties calling that, you know, something of ours has fallen or is about to fall or is creating risk, and he's got some great companies, a great company that comes in and does the majority of the work with the trees, so that's in there. Where, too.
Which site is that happening most?
It happened out back at the academy a couple of times on adjoining properties to the field, and it's happened at Batchelder Pond. There's been a little bit at Marston, but not so much encroaching on others. It's just been stuff that we had to limb and trim for safety.
What's the... I guess this is going to sound stupid, but what's our purpose with the pond?
Ownership. I mean, we own it. It's a community resource. It's been well used, and it's a.
You know, we go up there. We check it out, and I've gone up.
No, I'm not saying about you guys.
No. Let me finish. The reason I bring that up is because you can't believe how many people go up there. There's always folks sitting in their car, reading the newspaper, having a cup of coffee, or sitting out on the benches. It's amazing, and they love it. And they come up to me. They talk. Well, did you know? And you know, they kind of share their stories, but. We have a responsibility. Just like when we had the problem with the dam, it was our responsibility. Now, the town did the work for us, but we had to defray the cost. So it's ours.
Now, how much is out there? I forget.
How much?
Acreage?
Oh, I forget.
There's a lot out back.
It's quite a bit out back. Once you take the bridge that the Eagle Scout did and went out back, it's 10 acres anyway. 10 acres. Yeah, 10 acres out there. And we own it.
And we own it.
Was and it gifted to us?
In the past, only based on my experience, in the past, school groups have gone there, mm-hmm. have spent time doing nature walks or doing
ecological.
I don't know if it's being used now. I just know that I personally took groups there, mm-hmm. and we did ecological walks and testing of the waters and things like that. So I know for science purposes, it's a wonderful site.
But I don't, in my opinion, I don't think we do it now. I really don't.
I don't believe that we have a lot of students going out there now, given the distance and walking and getting the bus and all that. So I think you're right, Frank. It isn't used in that respect. It could be. I think that's the point. It could be. But we don't. It is more of a community spot. It's that simple.
How much is this community spot? I mean, a bottom line. Give me a bottom line number. How much is the community spot costing?
In annual costs?
Annual cost.
God, Keith.
40,000.
I don't think it's that much. I mean, on a $27,000 mowing contract, probably four of that might be the pond, $3,500. And on the repairs, we're probably doing, the last couple of cycles, we've probably done $8,000 or $9,000 each year. But I bet that it's not costing us much more than $12,000 or $13,000 a year, generally.
Okay.
I remind you that the land was given to you by the Kiwanis. We did some research. We
with
found
conditions.
All the deeds with conditions, and you can't sell it. We looked to see if we could sell it, and that if you chose to do that, then the land would be returned to those folks that are on the deed from the Kiwanis, mm-hmm. which I understand is no longer here. So we'd have to go back to the next group, and I believe it was the Trues. Yeah. So.
You need to go out fishing. You love it there.
Or ice skating in there.
Right now, there aren't any fish.
Well, that would have been.
I think it's only for kids.
Practical.
I think you can only. Children are the only ones that are able to fish there.
Take a child with you if you go.
Sorry, take your grandchild with you. Page
4 is playgrounds, and this is field maintenance. This is. We do the best we can. This is where you'll see ticks and grubs, the treatments. This is the fertilization that we do with Green World, I think is the vendor we've been using most recently to maintain. Obviously, you can see that some dollars being spent 2 years back at the academy on the field. That's when we did the slight seeding and then had some vandalism and had to redo some of the work out there. The larger amount, for what it's worth, has been assigned to Marston the last couple of cycles, only because other than the athletic field, there's not as much. At both Marston and Center School, you've got chips, you know, the wood chips, et cetera, mm-hmm. at the playground. So, mm-hmm.
sometime in your spare time.
Maybe. Yeah, no, please.
I would love to see the comparison between what they have in Northampton on their playground.
Equipment?
No, the surface,
oh, okay.
as compared to wood chips.
Oh, is it that rubber stuff?
Rubber on
top. Oh, yeah, that's it. Mm-hmm. I could Even I can bounce up and down.
It's really interesting.
Okay.
Yeah.
Surface.
I mean, okay. How long does that last, I wonder? I mean, that would be the other piece.
Mm. It lasts a long time, but there's issues of it getting on clothes. There's issues. Is this more expensive?
Well, I figured it would be more expensive.
I figured it was more expensive,
yeah,
but
and kids,
getting on clothes, really.
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
That's why a lot of people don't use it, because you can get the black marks.
Page 5.
Page
before
5.
We start talking about monkey bars.
Page 5 is vehicles. we have the two vehicles, the 06 facilities truck, and then we have the new panel van that we just bought when we arrived here in 2010. This is regular maintenance. We, you know, it's hard to project the
I take it you want to move quickly through this.
Yeah, mm-hmm. We've done.
I just want to keep us on task.
Okay. Well, I make the motion that if anything, you know. Is there any major issue coming out from any of the last two tabs?
No, we're doing.
We're almost done.
Almost done.
Did
you finish with
vehicles? I am filling vehicles.
Are you making a motion on something, Frank?
No, I just.
Well, why don't you on 2650?
35.
Yeah,
I make a motion. We accept it.
A second.
Okay. 2700.
Okay, transportation.
Oh, we did not vote.
I wrote it
paper.
Down 5-0. You're all on board. I heard consensus.
Thank you.
2,700 is student transportation. Five items here, I think, or six, yeah. Five. There's home to school. We're budgeting for, we're living in year 3. We're budgeting for year 4. I'm continuing to hear that First Student is talking about major increases with a number of their customers in the region when they renew. I think you've been at least 10 years with this vendor at the end of this deal. Durham Transportation has come from Texas, and they've bought a couple of firms in the area. Student Transportation of America owns Goffstown Truck. There's Salter in Massachusetts, not too far from us. There's at least 2 or 3 other firms, and I think that my suggestion would be it would be reasonable for us to go back through a competitive cycle. Again, what I would try to do is reach out to 21 and see where they're at, reach out with Exeter and see where everybody's going to be, because it's even better if multiples go out to bid at the same time, because it might engender a little more enthusiasm from a firm that isn't here. So,
well, the newer buses.
So you have a 5-year agreement.
It's a renewal on top of.
Okay, you can't. You're not suggesting that you open it up and go to bid this year.
No, but next year.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, next
right.
year.
Okay.
While I'm budgeting for my last year, I'll be talking to them about what to do next. Yeah, no. So that's up 3%. I did add in this account, based upon conversation with the principals and looking at the actuals, I added $1,200 beyond what is contracted. So if you look back at the notes. We added $2,800 for Marston School late bus, and then later we added $3,000 for Hampton Academy late bus. Those are running a collective $1,200 short in sure. point of fact. So I just added $1,200 to keep up with what the actual bills have been. So
the next time you negotiate the contract, you would include those as part of the contract?
Roll those in, yeah, so they wouldn't be additional costs.
Should we bump it up a little bit more just to take that into consideration, because more and more, I think Kathleen pointed out at the last meeting, we have more and more students taking advantage of our after-school program.
We do.
Okay, so now that puts the burden on the buses.
Well, when I say that, more and more, don't remember now, you have buses that are 80-plus passengers, so when I say more and more, I'm not talking about 80 kids on that bus, I'm talking 40. So
okay.
I think on the current buses we have room to grow, but we are seeing an uptick.
Mm-hmm. We'll talk. I've got some ideas about home-to-school transportation and the late bus, and you only have to walk out a couple of days and look at how few kids get on the buses after school, and then how many kids are sticking around to take the bus home at the late bus, and you start wondering, are there things that we could do with our routes in the afternoon so that we could put more focus, because our late buses, remember, are doing their best to do door-to-door stops and get kids home safely, especially as it gets dark, but it's a long ride home for some kids on the late bus. So we'll get, I think in this next cycle, we'll talk about, you know, or investigate ways that we might do some rerouting. And
biggest challenge for us is distance. Distance for that bus to go. When we make any moves on buses, you know, when we reroute,
We then have to worry about how long is that youngster going to be on the bus. So it's kind of a...
Because the buses aren't full, but you also don't want them out there for an hour and a half driving around. Right. So.
And what's the difference between our bus drivers and Pelham's?
In what?
And Pelham's.
Oh, you're talking about the strike. The strike. So for those that are listening at home, Superintendent, I think, communicated so the board would know, but everyone needs to know that on the seacoast, the terminals, to my knowledge, both Exeter serving part of the seacoast and our Hampton terminal serving the rest of the seacoast, they are non-union shops. And so they are contracted differently with First Student than are the Merrimack Valley and some of the Western. They're unionized with Teamsters, I think. And so they're talking, is it Teamsters? I think it's Teamsters. Mm-hmm. So they're talking about strike there because of contract terms or negotiations breakdown, but that won't affect us here.
That group is up in the Lakes region, Laconia, Guilford, up in there, however, there were districts that were concerned that it might trickle down to us.
The fact that we're talking a lot more about unionization, that might trickle, and you might see a union presence more, might be more likely here in the future, but that's not an overnight thing, so
okay.
For right now, we're all set. Page 3 is special needs. We talked when we came through special education about some out-of-district placements. Costs related to out-of-district placements are reflected here, and you can see that there is an increase.
It's a dramatic increase.
In the budget, it's from 145 to 166, so it's not huge.
No, I'm looking at...
But if you're looking at the actuals, yeah. So this provides not just for out-of-district, though. Remember, this is our home-to-school-to-home daily routes as well. In this account.
And summer
stuff, yeah. Page 4 is for the academy. This is our athletic budget for athletic transportation. You know, we put that in there. I got to ask Ellen before I get this to the budget committee if we are actually... I said generally to cover myself. I don't know if we're going to Vermont this year or not.
The cross country team goes there.
They
that's
do.
A regional. It's a pretty big deal.
Regional meet. Yeah,
it's a pretty big deal. It's been going on for a while.
For a long time. So field trips are on page 5. For what it's worth, you doubled this. There was some conversation. We don't come anywhere near covering the field trip costs. There's a lot of costs that are borne by the parents and the PTA donations and so on and so forth. We had carried $2,000 per building until this year, 16-17, and we double it to 4. So this is the first year that we're living with that.
Okay. Well, that's because I think that some of the schools, Hampton Academy in particular, were looking at going to the mills and things like
that.
Well,
are they still going to Lowell Mills?
I don't know. That's why we budgeted this, because of the...
I don't know if they are this year, so I'll have to look.
It was the play, the Christmas pageant play, and Rochester.
I don't know if they're still going to Lowell Mills. Not that it's going to make a dramatic change in your cost, but...
No, that was coming back.
I know they go to the Brown Center.
They couldn't go before because the budget was cut on the transportation.
Everything else there is pretty close. That's the only one.
I think we updated this that day sitting with the principals, but I'll ask them.
I think they go.
No, you're right. They are. Because they couldn't go because the money wasn't in the budget for the buses.
So you doubled it.
But here's another example. Today we learned that the 7th grade go to the Service Federal Credit Union in Portsmouth. So they got to hire buses. They have a wonderful financial literacy day for the kids in 7th grade. And they all go down there, but that's not even included. So there are...
That's a new one, though, right?
They've been going the last couple of years.
Okay. So that needs to...
Yeah, we can add that in. But there's stuff that comes up on field trips. You know that.
Absolutely.
Is the ski program at Hampton Academy self-funded?
Yes. Okay. I think for what it's worth, at Marston there has a couple of times been a stipend paid to an organizer to coordinate the parents and the kids and the paperwork and to go with them.
Right.
The principals go too.
But the transportation
is all included and paid for as a part of the fee. Other transportation on page 6, that's your McKinney-Ventoo line. I can only tell you that it's exciting to see that last year the number was down, but we've budgeted that up every year for a reason, and so I've left that flat. That's it for transportation.
A motion for...
make a motion, we accept it.
Yeah, $2,700, right?
Yep.
Second.
Seconded, Pepper. I guess we should vote.
Okay, all in favor?
Yep.
Okay. Yeah. 29.
$2,900, health benefits. So the first up is health insurance. I mentioned either 1% increase, 1.7%. If you look at the two pages that follow it, you've got to turn your book. What I give you there, and I've done this each year, at least the last two or three, I guess, these are next year's guaranteed maximum rates with a headcount, a headcount by category, the breakdown of cost sharing between the employee and the district. The first page is teachers, and you can see the buyouts for those that opt out of the coverage. And on the second page, you've got admin, paras, and non-union with their contribution rates as well, and all of the extended costs. So that's the scattergram kind of, if you want to call it that. That's the exercise that I go through to contemplate from the bill who we actually have. I anticipate to the extent that I can marriages, births, changing, and then try to assume, for instance, with retirees that are known, whether I'm going to replace those with families or what have you. And I try to pick and choose. You know, I think I'm going to get one single but two families, and I plug those in. But the headcounts, if you will, on the teachers, I do the teachers tab differently or separately because I tie that right back to the teacher body count, the head count, the number of positions, the number of people that I have, so that I have either a buyout or a coverage plan for each. So that's health insurance. The next page is dental, and there's a spreadsheet behind it that essentially does the same thing. There's an increase in the cost for dental. So two things happened. We increased our budget when we bumped to a better plan for the 16-17. So you can see that the actuals in 15-16 are not what today's actuals would be. Today's actuals would be closer to the 16-17 budget. And we increased the budget because we essentially doubled the coverage from a $750 maximum per year to $1,500 max per year. So following that, two things happened. One, more people took dental because it's a better plan for essentially the same money. And two, I think we found with a number of retirees going who were accustomed to not taking the dental because it was a weak plan, the new hires came in to a better plan and opted in. So the cost increase is only about $500 or $600, but that's what it's due to. It's due to the fact that I've got multiple people taking. Okay. Life insurance is anticipated to stay flat, and so is long-term disability. Long-term disability went up just a smidge. That's driven by salaries. But I had enough money. I had enough money in the budget already, so I only needed a couple of $100 to adjust to cover what's projected. Page six is FACA. That's your 7.65 taxes. Here's a big budget driver on page seven. We're about $180,000 of new cost for New Hampshire Retirement System contributions. $180,000 in new money because on the employee side, the rate that employers contribute went from 11.17 to 11.38. But the bigger one was where they took the teacher, our contribution on behalf of teachers, from 15.67 up to 17.36. Back under the info tab, I gave you the press release, if you will, of the rates from the retirement system. And on the back of it, there's a historical spreadsheet that shows you what the rates have done going back to 1971. And for what it's worth, you were somewhere between 4.6 and 5 all the way from 71 through to 06-07. Since 06-07, we've gone from 5.7, we're now up to 17%, and that's all driven by the conversation I know you heard about, the political conversation and otherwise, about the way the fund was managed. They're working hard to fully fund, if you will, the fund, because, or fully, what do I want to call it? It's The trust, there you go, fully fund the trust. The trust is underfunded right now for what it should be based on all projections, and they've shifted a lot of that back to the local employer. So,
want to keep that funded, right?
We do. So, beyond that, unemployment contributions, we're pooled through Primex for unemployment. Our rates dropped measurably. That's a result of the pool doing better and us doing well as a part of the pool. So you can see our costs going down about $7,000 there. In workers' compensation, we eat that right back up because we budgeted for the maximum 10% increase. I know more about unemployment right now because unemployment runs on a January to December calendar year, so I already know what my new year rate is. Workers' comp runs on a fiscal year, the same as property and liability, so I don't know. I'm just budgeting for the maximum. And then the fees are to cover our contribution against FSA plans and 403Bs. So those are your benefits.
Make a motion, we accept, is it 5,100?
Nope, 2,900.
I'll second.
2,900.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor? Unanimous.
Two more quick sections. Lots of savings here, but I want to caution you to make sure that you see the math. 5,100 is our debt services, our bond payments. So we had a budget of current year budget, $475,000, almost $476,000. Next year's budget is $140,000. That's a reduction of $335,000, and that's because the 96 edition at Marston was finally paid off. That bond is matured and done. What's left is two more years of payments against the Center School bond on the 99 edition that we did there. Ooh, it might be three more years. Sorry. But what I want you to see in the notes down below, I've kept this running each year. The savings to the local taxpayer is really only $235,000, not $335,000, because the building aid revenue is going away as well. So the state was paying a portion of that. So if you look last year, or this year, in 16-17, we got $138,000 in building aid revenue. Next year, we get $100,000 less, only $38,000. So the state was paying $100,000 of that bond payment, and that was the old building aid program. So when you look for savings, it's really not as significant. I mean, it's still significant, $235,000, but it's not as significant as you think because of the revenue that's attached. So we have a continued principal payment next year of $130,000 with interest payments of $10,000. That's debt service.
Make a motion, we accept it.
Second.
Moved and seconded.
Yeah, you have that.
5,100.
All in favor?
So I remind you, the last section there is, and then I have one more thing for the last section is food service. It's grossly appropriated, and we've had conversation a couple of times. The gross appropriation column you see, 17-18, it's 500 in the revenue and 500 in the budget, or 500 in the spending. So state law says that you must grossly appropriate for all potential spending, regardless of the source of funds. So my classic example is always, if Bill Gates comes to town, now Bill Gates isn't the richest guy around probably, but if Bill Gates comes to town and gives you $5 million, we'll all smile and say, thank you very much, can you come back next year? Because you have to have budget authority, you have to have appropriation authority to receive and spend the $5 million. If you just go ahead and take his check, you don't have the authority to spend an extra $5 million. You'll simply put it in the bank and give it back as a part of fund balance to offset taxes next year, right? You don't get to spend his $5 million. I remind people of that. The truth is there are some ways that we can get around that, obviously under state law, especially if Bill Gates really did give us money. But so this is gross appropriation. Food service is essentially a self-funded program, is intended to be. So I show the revenues and the expenditures offsetting in equal amounts. But I give you two columns. We won't make and spend a whole $500,000. Our costs are going to be somewhere in the 430 or 40 range. And so I've shown you a fiscal projection of revenues and expenditures. This reflects a 2% increase like we have elsewhere in the district. Although if Mary, for instance, came forward and said, I just can't do it, I got, you know, food costs are going up or what have you, we could make an adjustment to that because those aren't contracted positions, but we try to reflect the same kinds of increases to our support staff in the food service program as we do elsewhere. Continues to look like we'll stay in the black, not deeply in the black, just narrowly, but that's, okay, you know.
It's in the black.
Well, it shouldn't be a profit.
It's not supposed to be a profit center, right? Just supposed to break even.
Yeah, I don't know. But when they do make a little and they've made $1,000 here or $1,500, we put that in an account, and if Mary needs a new pressure cooker or a new piece of equipment, that's where it goes.
No. Yeah. I understand that.
But you're not making... You're just not making...
You're lucky if you make anything.
Yeah.
Okay.
Frank, you want to...
I make a motion, we accept it.
I'll second.
Food services. All those in favor?
Okay. Now, do you need a motion to accept the whole budget?
In the packet that I gave you tonight, you'll find this guy.
Okay. Oh, yeah.
I reflected all of the changes you made last time there, and I will work to make sure that all of the other summary pages get updated to reflect those changes. But if you want to go to that document that's dated November 3rd, in the top left-hand corner says November 3rd, and you want to go to the last page, let me walk you through this. Because we made no dollar changes in our continued conversation tonight, this reflects the changes that were made the other night. What it looks like right now is that the default budget would continue to represent an increase of $255,935, which is a 1.25% increase. The proposed budget that you want to get passed as you put this to the ballot would actually be $43,425 less than that, which would end up with leaving a number that is $20,635,850, a 1.04% increase over the current. I'll be very honest and tell you that as an OCD, proudly like I am, I'd want to go back and get rid of that 0.4% It killed me when the report came out like that, but that's what it would be. That's what we'd be taking forward to the budget committee if you approve it tonight, is a budget of $20,635,850. And you can see that the current budget number to match that is $20,423,340. Okay. So it's ultimately an increase of $212,510.
Move to accept. Pepper, second. We'll have discussion. Second. Frank, discussion. Frank?
Oh, sorry. LPN. Yes, the nurse.
That's part of the budget.
Yep.
Okay.
And we did not. You go ahead. Yep.
So, sorry. I got overzealous. So if you want to go back into the data that's in that packet as well on the LPN, the conclusions are down at the bottom. Here's what I did. I pulled LPN 1 and 2 because the position descriptions I thought would be important to figure out which one I should use. The difference between 1 and 2 is that 2 is supervisory. The basic functions are the same, except that 2 would supervise others. And so I think LPN 1 is more consistent with the position that we're looking to hire. That puts it in labor grade 16. I gave you labor grade 16 for 2016 and for 2017. If you look in the bottom quarter of the page, labor grade 16 for 2017 runs from 2107 to step 5, 2468. If you look back and found the 17 scale, it actually runs as high as $28 an hour, $27.93. The state is apparently not hiring beyond step 5. And I don't anticipate that we would be hiring a many, many year veteran. We'd be looking for somebody for whom this part-time role and these hours would work. And so I make the conclusion, one, that LPN 1 is probably most relevant to our discussion, that a starting wage somewhere between $21 and $25 or so seems reasonable. And then for information's sake, I provided some numbers for you so you could see what the entry-level nurse, mm-hmm. if you were hiring an RN,
on the teacher scale, a B1, the hourly rate would be just under $30. So we're not, I don't think anybody's proposing we go to $29 or $30, but you want to be careful not to scratch up too close to what the contracted RN would be making. But I have $22.50, I think, in the budget.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So yes. I leave it in your hands. I guess what I would say is I won't argue that the Frank asked the question. We may or may not have great success at $22.50. We are within our rights, obviously, if you'd like, to hire for a couple less hours or a couple less days or to be creative. And we can also come back and say, hey, it looks like we couldn't hire at $22.50. We need to hire at $23.50. $1 an hour costs us this much more. Are you okay with that? It'll have an impact. But I think that $22.50 was, in the analysis that I've done, a good starting place for a position that's new to us. So.
And how many hours are we looking at? 6.5, I think you said.
All right, let me just double check, make sure I know what I wrote.
5.
What I wrote up in here, 6.5.
6.5. Yeah, yeah. That's why I was.
Stays out of the types of retirement. It's not a.
I understand that, but here's what you're. This is what you're facing. Okay, you're either going to have to cut back the hours to 29. And I know why I'm saying 29, because I'm involved with the state, okay? But if you go into 32.5, okay, you're only 7 hours, 5 hours. At the state, it's 37.5.
Right, that's it.
In most cases, you know where I'm going at.
Yep.
It's a 5-hour difference, 1 hour a day. You could probably not find somebody because that's all the difference, 5 hours a day, is between benefits and no benefits. When you're competing with the state. That's basically what I'm saying. So you either have to cut back the hours, okay, or you're going to have to go to a full-time position.
I'm not sure that's necessarily true, because what's attractive about this position is that you may get some person who... They want to work in schools. I've seen that a number of times. That's what they want to do. So you might not be competing necessarily with somebody who wants the full-time job or the hospital or something like that.
I'm just throwing it out.
Yeah.
Just throwing it out. And I specifically, when I put the 32.5 in here, the 6.5 hours, it was to avoid having to kick in 11.38%, because... For today, I didn't want it didn't seem like what we were trying to do was create a career track position. We were trying to, quite honestly, trying to create like a health aides position, but not have it be a paraprofessional position that is bound kind of by day and by the hours. Because one of the really neat ideas was that maybe this position could not start at 7:30 or 8:00; it could start at 9:30 or 10:00 and go till 4:00, because the nurses go home. They don't go home quickly, but they go home, right. And there's nobody really covering as a first responder all these kids that we're bussing back and forth. We're talking about after-school programs, and wouldn't it be great? Mm-hmm. We don't have after-school programs like that running with a great concentration of kids every day, Monday through Friday, but Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, it'd be really neat to have somebody whose schedule allowed for that kind of support. And then I got another body in the building to help with subs, and when it's time for summer program, I got somebody who's not necessarily an RN, but could be a great resource to the special ed summer school program for 4 or 6 weeks in the summer, July, for some number of hours. So,
okay,
it was multi-layered, but I don't know until we go out and try to hire it what I'm going to face trying to hire them away from everywhere else.
You still consider the 32.5. It's not the 37 now, because isn't the state something if you go over 30 hours?
On
a regular day in and day out schedule, you're going to have to offer some partial benefit.
I think even at this, like our paras have access to one.
Yeah.
And so the intent would be to categorize this and offer a comparable package.
Okay.
We'll have to decide whether we're going to do it based on the para plan or the support staff plan. But I think part of it is ramping ourselves up to a point where we could chase this out there and hire it and talk about how the schedule works. And, for instance, we might be able to solve that, if you'd like, by by having a longer day, like a seven-hour day, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and having a much shorter day, maybe Monday and Friday, and only having a four-hour. Now you're getting pretty. Now you're getting dicey about who would be available and who would be interested.
So we can't lose sight also of the reason we wanted to do this.
Right.
Is because we've seen an uptick in the number of children who need some medical oversight.
No,
so,
I understand that.
You know, it's going to be also dependent on the numbers of medical kinds of plans we have for youngsters at all three schools. So it's kind of, I wish that was more definitive, but we're trying to.
Do you want to make a motion to change that rate from $22.50 to...
No. Okay. The rate's fine with me. I have no problem with the rate.
We've got to be careful about the hours.
Because I know... But if he's got it covered, that's fine. Because I know even at 32.5, when you're doing that day in and day out, that triggers the partial benefits.
That's right.
Okay.
Yeah, so we're...
And we'll do that.
Yeah. So if he's got it... No, I have... Complete confidence.
We have to fix, we'll have to fix the next cycle. But I think this was an attempt at trying to start it without being overzealous was the hope. So
I make the motion we accept it as is.
Well, I think we already have a motion
accept it. Peppa moved and Frank seconded.
Yep.
Okay.
The budget.
The
bottom line budget. Okay.
And that amount was
$20 million.
Sorry, $20,635,850. That's 1.04% increase.
Yep.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
One more.
We just have one
thing. Where is it? Hold on. One of these piles is the warrant.
Yeah. While he's doing that, did I give you one of these? Did you ask me that?
Okay. Good.
We'd like to take this time to commend Nate and the superintendent for putting together and. Budget that was probably not that easy to do, but you did it.
It's right here. Thank you very much. Here.
Thank you.
I wanted to give you.
Yeah, just give me two.
Yeah, I wanted to give you a shot.
I have mine, so go ahead.
This is a draft of the budget. A draft of the warrant. No action needed tonight. Just wanted you to see it because we might like to take action more quickly than normal. And I'll explain. On December 8th, the Budget Committee would really like us to come in with the whole ball of wax. They'd like us to come in with our entire warrant, all of our money articles, because they'd like to not entertain another meeting with us in January like they have been. So, you voted on the budget, so we've got that.
Mm-hmm.
This is the language that we anticipate would be appropriate for the building project. And so if, when we meet next week and the committee makes their recommendation, the project advisory committee makes its recommendation to you, and we give you cost items, we can, at some point as quickly thereafter, that night or another night soon, agree to put it on the ballot. Even if you wanted to make some adjustments between now and January, if we get some action from the board, I can take this warrant and that money article and we can put it on the presentation for the budget committee that night. So that's Article 1. Article 2 is the budget. Article 3 is the long-term maintenance article that we do with Keith each year. I can tell you just quickly, there's some placeholders here. The biggest chunk of this, probably 200,000 of it, will go to phase 2 of the roof on Marston. So Marston, if you can think of it, look at it from the sky. Keith, somebody said back along, it's like a jet plane with a big tail, right? So the nose of it is the kitchen and the cafeteria, and then the wings are the third grade. The SAU took over one side and third grade on the other. We did the roof over the SAU and the main street and the administrative corps with the nurse and the and the cafeteria, a big chunk of the cafeteria. That we did that this summer. Next phase is the other third grade wing and the rest of the annex and the kitchen, and maybe a little bit moving up the 75 wing, like over those new bathrooms that we did. And then the third phase, which would be the subsequent year, is to go from there back to the two-story 96 addition. So three phases, but the first one costs us a couple hundred grand. We expect this next one to be about 200. I'm trying to make magic because that last stretch is probably gonna be more like 300 and change. But anything, if the rates come good and we can bite off some of that this next summer. So that's what that is. That's three phase. We started replacing classroom sinks and countertops at Center School two years ago, and then we did more this last vote. We did a lot of that this summer. He'd like to continue to do some at Center School, and he's got some he'd like to tackle at Marston School. So we may see those. And then we have some dollars from last year to work on hardening of rooms, tagging back to the Ogonst group, the Navy SEAL guys that were here and talked about this room and that room and hardening the doors, the hardware and the literally the thickness of the door, et cetera. Mm-hmm. We haven't done that. We did the digital cameras and we've worked on some other pieces. We're going to move ahead and do some of that. But there might be a piece related to the implementing or related to those security improvements. Mm-hmm. And there's some other features of security that I think we should talk about as well with the board. And then he's working with Palmer Sicard, our HVAC plumbing crew, on heating and cooling. We've collected some data, and we're setting in place the opportunity to collect more data so that the board could be in a position to talk about what are the living temperatures in our classrooms at different portions of the year. The greatest focus, I think, is on the shoulder seasons, May, June, and then in the fall, September, or so when we come back, to talk about what kind of systems we could put in place to try to knock down. And so you may want to see some of those dollars allocated to some air quality and some HVAC concerns that way. So. Keith and I will work more on that in the next couple of weeks, and we'll bring that back to you as soon as we can. But I wanted you to see this. The very last page, just as a reminder.
Just one more thing.
Oh, sorry,
we
yes.
did get notice from Sacred Heart. They are interested in
yes.
child benefit. Teresa sent me the numbers for next year. I believe it's 41. And so we're just costing that out, and we'll have a number for you. But there is an intent for them to continue with their child benefit.
So those are the only four articles. I think that probably will be it for our four articles, for our warrant. Only one position, only one board seat open for the election. But that last page is an excerpt out of the town report for the town side. On the last warrant, we had an article along with the Hampton Academy project that said, shall the school board accept transfer of the two pieces of property, the Arnold property and Martell property, the bus loop is on and the parking lot is on, accept transfer of that from the town. We didn't have any suspense date, any contingency date, we just said, shall we? And the vote was supportive yes. The town had this article, but you read that this article said, contingent upon the successful passage of the currently proposed bond issue. I haven't spoken to council yet, but I think it's going to be a stretch to suggest that a supportive vote, which we got on that, could be stretched to say that the currently proposed is the same this year as it was last year. We probably will need the town to put this on their article, on their warrant again, and support it. So as not to forget it, that language probably needs to go, and when you folks have your audience with the selectmen, it might be an appropriate topic to bring up and say, would you guys put this on your ballot, please? To promote. I don't believe that we have to put it on ours again because the intent was clear and we didn't make any contingencies, so I think we're all set. But this one will need it.
So I would like to take the liberty of trying to set up a meeting with the selectmen so that you can discuss this warrant article. I'm sure that we're going to hear from them around the cable request. And then I'm sure that you want to talk to them a little bit about the Hampton Academy project. So you have three items that you could discuss. You wanted to go and meet with them just to let them know what your intent is for this current year.
You folks want to do that? Yes. I'm asking.
It's the right thing to do.
Yeah.
It's
okay.
So why don't I go ahead and see what's available? Then it would be a good time for us to come. It's always a Monday night, and I will get back to you on a date.
Hopefully it will be after January, or you need it before January.
Well, we need the warrant article discussed because they're going to develop their warrant.
Okay.
And also the television, the cable request will probably come up, so...
You want it in December, then?
Yeah, I was thinking of a Monday in December.
It has to be Monday in December.
How about try to shoot for the first...
December, correct?
Correct.
Right. Say that again?
They only meet Monday nights.
Like once or twice in December.
If I try for the first Monday in December?
first one I can make. I can't make the second Monday.
Before our meeting. So
let me try to see if I could set something up for the first Monday. Okay. Thank you. I agree with Andrea that it is the right thing to do and to share with them what your intent is for this year's warrant.
I'd like to make a motion that we adjourn.
Second.
Yeah, Joe, just hold off just 2 seconds.
He does this all the time.
No, because last week I wanted to do it and we had already adjourned and it probably would have been inappropriate. We have to do the superintendent's evaluation. I've been getting dribs and drabs. You gave these to administrators or other folks. So some are assigned, some are unsigned, but they've been showing up at my house in dribs and drabs. What's your pleasure on doing that? I don't know how you folks have done it before.
I think we've done it during one of the meetings, haven't we?
No,
we've done it separate date.
We go to the SAU office.
Right.
And then
the SAU office.
And then we compile, what did you give the superintendent, what did you give, and then we come up with an average. So
okay.
We need to choose a date.
Yeah. And it has to be posted.
And I don't think I have all of these yet. Because I just got one today, and, they're kind of coming in and...
What, all the evaluations?
Well, from the admin team.
You should be getting call it 10.
And
I think I have 4.
Given to them in a mandatory way.
Okay.
So you may not.
Did we do that last year?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So
I remember us all meeting and going through that. Vote for.
Yeah.
Do you want to aim for a day next week, later on in the week, or you want to?
We've got meetings. We got a meeting on Wednesday next week.
I got Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. Budget Tuesday, Thursday. School on Wednesday. So I can either do Monday or Friday.
Well, next week.
Thursday, December 1st. That's for anybody?
Yeah, I like that.
Yeah.
December 1st. That pushes it out.
Earlier or?
5:30.
No, we got to talk to Jane.
I can't meet.
6 o'clock. 6 o'clock.
Yeah, 6:30. 5:30 is too early.
Okay.
6
o'clock.
I'm on Monday. I got to drive back, and who knows if there's snow.
So Thursday, December 1st at 6 o'clock.
Okay.
December
6th.
And that would be at...
What's that, up in the SAU office?
SAU office. Is that posted as a work session?
Yes.
I make a motion we have pizza that...
that night? Okay.
Well, at that point, you're going to
a 6-pack.
It's a personnel matter.
Yeah, okay.
Only joking. Sorry.
Frank, did you have a motion to make?
I make a motion that we adjourn.
Second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
I think...